Thank you very much. I hope that the practical difficulties will now be solved. I so just need to tell you when to change it. For a start, I would like to give you some comment about the background of the proposal back in April 2018. The PowerPoint now. Which I can't see.
We can see the slides, Georgie, and we can hear you. You can continue. Thank you very much.
Yes, yes, perfect. Okay, very good. So if you can start with the first page. So the context of the, which is a little bit further up, the context was that there had been a quick success of scam. I'm sorry, is there any way? Yeah, and maybe the second slide, let's say. This is going to be tricky with me teleguiding you from Brussels. A little bit before the previous slide. And the, yes, here we are. Thank you. So, revealed by whistleblowers, you take your pick, LuxLeaks, Panama Papers, Paradise Papers, Cambridge Analytica, Dieselgate, which were all revealed. By whistleblowers and were the wrongdoing that the national borders. And these scandals also illustrated that insufficient protection in one country, but also in other countries and also possibly in the EU as a whole. And all this happened against the background of uneven member states, with some having comprehensive education, but with most member states having sectorial protection for whistleblowers, for instance, only for public servants or only for people reporting on corruption. The same situation was the same also at EU level. So there were elements of whistleblower protection in environmental rules, in transport safety rules, and especially in the area of financial services, where they had been introduced after the financial crisis that had revealed serious enforcement weakness. The Commission understood that it was time to have a more proactive approach and not just a way to respond to human harms. And there were also strong calls for legislation from the European Parliament and stakeholders. If you can move to the next slide. There had been a lot of indications that we found in studies and surveys we conducted about the reasons for underreporting and the consequences of underreporting. For instance, we saw that basically 8 out of 10 Europeans who witnessed or experienced corruption would not report on it. And we also carried out a study specifically on public procurement, where we found out that effective whistleblower protection in the area of public procurement would lead to benefits between basically 6 to 10 billion euros for the whole EU. The next slide, please. And We also had indications about the reasons for underreporting, the main reason being fear of retaliation. So consistently, workers reported that they wouldn't report because of fear of legal and financial consequences. However, there were also other reasons, notably the lack of trust in whistleblowing, the fact that they thought, oh, I wouldn't be able to prove my concerns, and even if I could, nothing would happen, the responsible would not be punished. There was also lack of knowledge about where and how to report. And last but not least, there were also sociocultural factors, the negative perceptions of whistleblowers, which were the third most important reason for people not to report. If you can please change the slide. If you can go back to the objectives. Okay, the main objective of the directive was to strengthen enforcement, exactly because whistleblowers' reports feed national and EU authorities, enforcement authorities, with information that can help them detect, prevent, and address violations of protection is also meant to protect and promote freedom of expression, because retaliation against whistleblowers restricts their freedom of expression. It also had a positive impact on the watchdog role of investigative journalists, exactly because whistleblowers are crucial sources for investigative journalists, and reassuring them that they will be protected if their identity is exposed can promote media freedom. If you can please change the slide. In the meantime, I can only, where the material scope is. A little before? Thank you. Yes. A little before, two slides before, probably. The previous one and the one before. Yeah, here you are. So exactly because the focus was on strengthening enforcement of EU law, we had to carefully select the material scope of the directive to determine it in a way which is in line with the principle of subsidiarity. So we selected areas where whistleblower protection could support and add value to the efforts of national and EU authorities, enforcement authorities, so as to strengthen the enforcement of EU rules. The criteria that we used was that there should be areas where violations of EU rules would result in serious harm to the public interest, where there were weaknesses. I think you should still try to go back to the slide where the material scope is mentioned. Yes. So where there is serious harm to the public interest, where whistleblower protection can help strengthen enforcement because there are identified weaknesses in enforcement. So we select these areas. If I can summarize them, I would say that first of all, it's about rules that contribute to the good functioning of the single market. So we're talking about protection of reports of breaches of rules on public procurement, financial services, anti-money laundering, competition, corporate tax rules, and tax arrangements that result in tax evasion and distort fair tax competition. Then we're talking about breaches of rules in policy areas which are directly relevant for the single market, but which directly affect the well-being and the daily lives of Europeans. And here we're talking about rules on product safety, transport safety, environmental protection, nuclear safety, public health, food safety, data protection, And last but not least, breaches of rules that affect the EU's financial interests, basically illegal activities affecting the EU budget. To go to the next slide, although we had to carefully select the material scope of the directive, we strongly encourage member states, when transposing the directive, to consider extending its scope of application also to other areas and to ensure a comprehensive and coherent framework at the national level. This brings a number of benefits in terms of increasing accountability, transparency, good governance, in terms of contributing to the fight against corruption. It can also benefit the investment climate and increase trust in public institutions. But it's also beneficial in terms of ensuring legal certainty and clarity for whistleblowers. And basically, if, for example, a member state puts in place good, efficient reporting channels and strong protection for persons reporting on mismanagement of EU funds, there is no reason that it wouldn't do the same when people report on mismanagement of national funds. If we can go to the next slide, the personal scope of the directive. So it's clear that for the enforcement of EU rules, it is necessary to provide protection to the widest possible range of categories of persons who, by reason of their work-related activities, have privileged access to information that may be in the public interest to report, and who may suffer retaliation because of this reporting. So protection is granted under the directive, not only to the workers, to the employees stricto sensu, but also in to persons in non-standard employment relationships, the most precarious ones, such as part-time workers or persons who have contracts with temporary agencies and so on. Protection is also granted to the self-employed, so suppliers, freelance workers, contractors, to shareholders of companies, to volunteers, unpaid trainees, job applicants, everyone who can report from the inside information about breaches of EU rules and who may suffer retaliation for it. If we can pass to the next slide, protection is also granted not only to the persons who report, but also to the ecosystem, let's say, that surrounds whistleblowers. So protection is also granted to facilitators, the persons who in the work-related context support, advise whistleblowers, to any third persons connected with the whistleblowers who may also suffer retaliation in the work-related context, relatives, colleagues, and to legal entities that are owned by whistleblowers or for which whistleblowers work or that are connected with the whistleblowers. If we can move to the next slide. One of the main protection elements, let's say, of the directive is to ensure that there are effective and widely available internal channels for reporting by the whistleblowers. So all private companies with 50 or more employees and all public entities are required to set up effective internal reporting channels, ensuring confidentiality. If we can go to the previous slide, please. Public entities. All to support to achieve economies of scale and reduce costs, it is possible for them to share resources in terms of receiving reports and in terms of investigation of reports. And member states also have the possibility to extend by 2 years the deadline for these medium-sized companies to set up internal reporting channels. When it comes to public entities, member states may exempt from the obligation to set up internal channels entities with less than 50 employees and smaller municipalities. And also, internal channels may be shared between municipalities or operated by joint municipal authorities. So the next slide. When it comes to the requirements for the internal reporting channels, they must ensure confidentiality of the identity of the whistleblower. This is an essential ex ante protection measure for whistleblowers. The whistleblower should receive an acknowledgement of receipt of the report within 7 days. All these organizations should have a person or a department designated competent for following up on the report, and they should follow up diligently on this report. They should give feedback to the whistleblower on the follow-up to this report within 3 months. And also, all these organizations should provide clear and easily accessible information about the procedures for reporting, but also the conditions and procedures for a person to report externally to the competent authorities. So if you see all these requirements, they are all meant to address the reasons for underreporting that we had identified. For instance, the fear of retaliation, so there is protection of the confidentiality, the sense of futility, that nothing will happen. This is why it's important to give feedback to the whistleblower and also diligently follow up on the report. Also, the provision of information so that people can make informed decisions about where, when, and how to report. If we can move on to the next slide. When it comes to the external competence authorities. The directive leaves it up to member states to designate the authorities competent. Here you can see some examples. You can move to the next slide. Their tasks, channels that ensure confidentiality, that are operated by staff members who have received specific training. They should allow persons to report in writing or orally or even by a physical meeting if they wish to. Again, the person should receive the prompt acknowledgement of receipt in 7 days. The competent authorities should diligently follow up on reports, which means assess the accuracy of the allegations, and then if they find them and then proceed to an investigation or to a prosecution or launch an action for recovery of funds, depending on the breach identified. Or alternatively, they might refer the report to another authority. So the directive leaves it open for a member state either to allow for a decentralized system of reporting, so that if, for example, I have a report on a breach of rules on environmental protection, I report to the Environmental Protection Agency, or to have a central system, so one single authority that receives the reports and refers them to the different competent authorities, depending on the substance of the report. So the next tasks are, of course, to give feedback to whistleblower within, again, 3 months. But if the subject matter is particularly complex and a lengthy investigation is required, there can be a prolongation of this deadline up to 6 months. The authority should also communicate to the whistleblower the final outcome of the investigations, and in any case, provide on a separate, easily identifiable and accessible section of their website very detailed information about whistleblowing procedures, remedies in case of retaliation, the confidentiality regime, what kind of feedback the person could expect, and so on. Finally, the tasks of the competent authorities will also be, if we can move to the next Yeah, this one is good. To regularly review the procedures, the directive asks that authorities review their procedures every 3 years, and also to collect statistical data. Member states are obliged to provide us with information every year on the number of reports they received, the number of investigations they launched, the outcome of these investigations, and if there was a financial damage estimated, the estimates, and possibly also the amounts recovered. So this would allow to assess the actual impact on the ground of the new rules on whistleblower protection. We also give the possibility to our member states to provide for some measures to ensure the effectiveness of the procedures by allowing to alleviate the burden on authorities. For instance, in case of high inflows of reports, to prioritize the ones which concern serious breaches, or to decide that the reported breach is clearly minor, or a repetitive report does not need follow-up, and so on. If we can move on now to the next. Slide, which should be the conditions for protection. So to qualify for protection, a person must have reasonable grounds to believe that the information reported was true at the time of the reporting and that it fell within the scope of the applicable rules. This condition, that a person must have reasonable grounds to believe that the information was true at the time of the reporting, is an essential safeguard against malicious or frivolous reports. So persons who report wrong information should receive no protection. But on the other hand, and if a person in of the involves that there was no breach, then this person should not lose protection. Whistleblowers are encouraged to use internal reporting channels first, where the breach can be addressed effectively and where they consider that there is no risk of retaliation. In fact, all evidence points that the overwhelming majority of whistleblowers tend to report internally first, and even many times if their concerns are not addressed the first time. This comes from the duty of loyalty, but also it's the first port of call. People fixed and concerns addressed within their organization. If they do not have any reason to fear retaliation, for instance, because the employer is involved in the breach, or if they have no concerns about a lack of confidentiality in the reporting channels, in those cases, they should be encouraged to report internally first. However, they are free to choose the appropriate channel, so they can also go directly externally, and they shouldn't lose protection if they do that. When it comes to the protection in case of public disclosures, if we can move to the next slide. Normally, a bit, yeah, here we are. So when persons report externally or internally and externally, but still their concerns are not addressed. They are not appropriately assessed, they are not investigated, or there is no appropriate remedial action taken. Then they can go to a public disclosure and they will be protected. However, there are cases where they can go directly to a public disclosure, notably if they reasonably believe that there is an imminent or manifest danger, there is an emergency situation of harm for the public interest or a risk for the physical integrity of a person. In those cases where there is a need for is danger for this, they may go directly to a public disclosure. Or They can go directly to the public disclosure if they have reasonable grounds to believe that if they reported externally to the competent authorities, they would risk retaliation, or that that due to the particular circumstances of the case, there would be a low perspective that the breach would be effectively addressed. Because, for instance, the authorities are in collusion with the perpetrator of the breach, or are involved in the breach, or they might be or destroyed. If we can move on to the next, the form of retaliation against the persons falling within its personal scope and meeting its conditions. So the starting point is that if retaliation is undeterred and unpunished, then it results in loss. This is why the directive requires that retaliation is prohibited in law, so that this can have a dissuasive effect. Can you please move to the next, in the next slide? A very long list, that's it, of forms of retaliation. This is an indicative list. So, but at the same time, it's a constitutive list, which means that these examples of forms of retaliation should be transposed as such in the national laws, which can also provide for further examples. But because imagination has no limits, and there may be also different forms of retaliation, these are purely examples of retaliation against which whistleblowers should be protected. Some of them are typical forms of retaliation against employees, like suspension or dismissal or negative performance assessment. Others are forms of retaliation from which service providers can suffer, like, for instance, an early termination of a contract or business boycotting. And some can happen to any of the whistleblowers. Discrimination, harassment, intimidation, damage also to reputation, and so on. When it comes to the measures for the support of whistleblowers, so the next slide, the directive provides, first of all, as a support measure, access to comprehensive and independent information and advice, which should be easily accessible to the general public and free of charge. If we can move to the next slide. This means that if, for instance, while I have read the information provided in my organization, the information provided at the website of the competent authorities, but still I have a lingering doubt, is my concern covered by the law? Which are the right channels to report it? They're able to have online post me, and that can give me further information on remedies I hope you can hear me again. I think there was a disconnection for a moment. Effective assistance by the authorities in terms of proof, for example, that they have reported externally to the authorities, and where it is provided by national law to certification, to a sort of proof that they meet the conditions to qualify for protection under the national law. Access to legal aid, exactly, because whistleblowers may suffer from significant costs linked to the legal fees if they are contesting retaliation measures. They should have access to legal aid in line with existing EU directives when it comes to criminal and cross-border civil proceedings, and member states may provide for further access to legal aid under national law. Member states may also provide for financial assistance and even including psychological support for reporting persons, again in accordance with national law. When it comes to remedies in case of retaliation, if we can move to the next slide. So one of the typical measures of protection for whistleblowers is the reversal of the burden of proof. This is an institution that is quite common in anti-discrimination rules. So let's say when a woman is announces to the employer that she is pregnant and she is fired, it's not for the woman to prove that she was fired because of her pregnancy, but rather for the employer to prove that this was not linked to the pregnancy. So a similar reversal of the burden of proof is provided for by the directive. So if a person reports and then he suffers a detrimental measure from the employer, let's say dismissed, then it's for the employer to prove that this measure is not linked in any way, it's not prompted by the report, but it is taken on justified grounds, for example, weak performance. Also, whistleblowers who suffer retaliation should have at their disposal adequate remedial measures, which should be appropriate depending on the form of the retaliation. So if, for instance, they are dismissed, they should be able to launch an action for reinstatement or an action for damages, an action for compensation, and so on. And most importantly, they should have at their disposal interim relief. They should be able to ask for interim measures while there are protracted legal proceedings going on, for instance, to stop harassment they suffer in the workplace or to prevent their dismissal. Another remedial in case of breaches of non-disclosure clauses. Most of us, private employees, public servants, we have in our contracts loyalty clauses, non-disclosure agreements that we sign. These clauses and agreements should in no way be used to prevent or punish the reporting of violations of EU rules that can cause harm to the public interest. So this cannot be used to deny protection or to penalize the whistleblowers. Similarly, in case a whistleblower is sued for copyright or of data protection rules or a disclosure of trade secrets, they should be able to rely on the fact that they reported or they made the public disclosure in accordance with the conditions of the directive to seek dismissal of the case in court, provided, of course, that they reported or made the public disclosure with a view to reveal a breach of EU rules covered by the directive. And last but not least, the directive provides for protection from liability for the acquisition of the information. So if the act of acquiring the information entails civil, administrative, employment-related, labor law liability, and so on, there should be an exemption from liability, except if the person has committed a self-standing criminal offense. In that case, the liability continues to be governed by the national criminal law. Next slide. The directive provides also for penalties that member states should put in place to ensure the effectiveness of its rules. So member states should provide for effective, proportionate, and dissuasive penalties against those who hinder reporting who retaliate against whistleblowers, who bring vexatious proceedings against whistleblowers, or who breach the duty of confidentiality of the identity of the whistleblowers. And the directive also provides for safeguards for the persons concerned by the reports. If we can move to the next slide. So, member states should ensure that the persons concerned by the report should fully enjoy the right to an effective remedy, the presumption of innocence, the rights of defense, including the right to be heard and the right to access their file, and they should ensure that the identity of these persons is protected as long as the investigations are ongoing. Member states should also provide for effective, progressive, and proportionate penalties against persons who knowingly report or publicly disclose false information. If we can move back. So, member states should also ensure that these penalties are there to deter malicious and or frivolous whistleblowing, but also to preserve the credibility of the system of whistleblowing. And member states should also provide for measures for compensating damage resulting from such reporting. And then if we move to the slide about more favorable treatment. Another couple of things to remember in the context of the transposition of the directive is that member states may introduce or retain more favorable provisions to the rights of whistleblowers, and that in any case, there is a clause of non-regression. So the transposition of this directive should under no circumstances lead to lowering the protection already available in national law. And a few words on the next steps. So, member states have to transpose their directive in the national law by December next year. We are currently supporting transposition efforts through an expert group which allows for exchanges of good practices. At the moment that we will be notified all the transposition measures, we will start assessing whether the transposition is full, correct, and we will issue a report at the latest 2 years after the deadline for transposition has expired. And then later on, so 4 years later, we will issue also a report on the implementation of the directive and on the need to amend. And then basically, we'll be assessing that implementation report. Is next one. We will evaluate how the directive has functioned, assess whether there is a need to amend it, possibly also extend its scope, for instance, to include social policy rules, the existing cooperation mechanisms, because right now when breaches have crossed them and so on. And at the very end of my presentation, I would like just to if you can just move the slide to point to the communication that we issued together with the proposal for the directive, which indicates several good practices that could be of help in the implementation of the rules of the directive. I think I've taken all my time, but I guess that the PowerPoint can be distributed. But let's say it presents how member states authorities, but also business organizations, employers organizations, umbrella organizations can help and support in different ways the implementation of the directive in a way as to maximize its effectiveness. Thank you very much. I'm sorry for all the technical problems. I hope that now we'll be able at least to connect normally and listen to your question.